Hi, welcome to this worship service and reflection here from First Congregational United Church of Christ. I'm Reverend Dave Forsberg with you here on this Sunday before Memorial Day. Glad you could be with us. Of course, tomorrow is Memorial Day, and we'll speak a little bit more about that. But first, would you join me now in prayer as we begin this reflection here inside our holy sanctuary today? Let us pray. God of the Holy Spirit, you are the restless breath of love that sweeps through the world. You move where you will, breaking down barriers, stirring hearts to change, making all things possible. Inspire each of us, all of us, to hunger and thirst for justice. Sweep through the world, God, to bring great change. And may the bounty of your goodness be shared more justly, so all may share in the rich blessings of your creation. And for us, bring transformation in our praying and living, so that we may act justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you all the days of our lives. Amen. Well, very glad that you could be with us for worship today and to have us reflect on this Memorial Day weekend inside our sanctuary. Let's begin with our call to worship. And if you've been with us before, the way this works is I will say some words, and then I will say, join me in saying together, and then say those words with me. Here is our call to worship. Gentle and patient, and we say together, God, you are calling. God, you are calling. Careful and persistent, we say together, God, you are calling. God, we are calling. In grieving and in praise, God, you are calling. And we say together, God, you are calling. Throughout the dawn and at midday and throughout the evening and into the early morning hours, God, you are calling. And let us say together, God, you are calling. Unexpected and planned, God, you are planning. And we say together, God, you are calling. In a still small voice and in power, God, you are calling. Let us say together, God, you are calling. Spontaneous and prepared, God, you are calling. And we say together, God, you are calling. Willing or protected, we say together, God, you are calling. God, you are calling. Our God is eager to share with us. Wherever we may be in life on our journey, may we be diligent to listen. God, you are calling. And we say together, God, you are calling. My friends, we, of course, throughout the week have come and at times been sinful people. So join me now in our confession of sins. Dear God, too often we are hesitant in our proclamation, seeking safe and suitable opportunities to speak of our faith. God, too often we are half-hearted in our service and reluctant to stand out from the crowd or to attract criticism. God, too often we live as if dependent wholly on our own resources, relying on our perceived skills and modest insights. Too often, Lord, we look to the clouds for our inspiration in the vain hope of finding you there. God, forgive the poverty of our efforts, the frailty of our faith sometimes, but open wide our hearts and minds to the presence of our living Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Our sermon is coming up, but first I'd like to read what our sermon here at the church was based on today. And it specifically comes from Mark 4, 26 through 34. And today in our scripture passage, we have Jesus preaching using two parables. Hear now these words from Mark 4, verses 26 through 34. Jesus said, "The kingdom of God is as if someone would scatter seed on the ground and would sleep and rise night and day, and the seed would sprout and grow. He does not know how. The earth produces of itself first the stalk and then the head, than the full grain in the head. But when the grain is ripe, and once he goes in with his sickle, because of the harvest has come. Jesus also said, "With what can we compare the kingdom of God, or what parable will we use for it? It is like the mustard seed, which when sown upon the ground is the smallest of all the seeds on earth. Yet when it is sown, it grows up and becomes the greatest of all shrubs and puts forth large branches so that the birds of the air can make nests in its shade." Those are the words from Mark. Well, grace and peace to you from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So glad that you're with us here in this reflection on the service that we had today, and a reflection, of course, on what we just heard in Mark, and looking ahead tomorrow to Memorial Day. So this morning, in our parable of the growing seed and the mustard seed, we hear Jesus doing what he does, using the parables to teach and to speak. Now, I know many of you were not with us last Sunday, but in last Sunday's service, we presented the Pentecost, that is, the apostles and all the followers of Jesus Christ receiving the Holy Spirit. And of course, we too have been given the Holy Spirit. In that scene in Galatians, where we were presented with the scene of the Pentecost, we saw and heard in our scripture from that Sunday, not Jesus, but rather Peter, giving essentially the very first sermon of what would later go on to become the church. He begins to preach after he has received the Holy Spirit. And then he goes out and, of course, works with others to help proclaim and spread what we know today to be the church headed by Jesus Christ, and foster what we know today as Christianity. So that's where we were at last Sunday. And so here today, we find Jesus talking about that kingdom that has been proclaimed and that is starting to spread because of Peter and the apostles and those early followers. They put into practice what we call, again, the church. So we hear, of course, that the Holy Spirit has been given to us as it was to Peter and the apostles and the other followers last week. We hear those words that we just looked at in Mark. What's very important to think about when we think of the Holy Spirit coming to us is the spreading of the kingdom of God, which Jesus, of course, uses in the parables this morning. And those parables, of course, talk about the spreading of the kingdom. But sometimes when we think about the parables and we think of these particular proclamations by Jesus of the parable of the mustard seed and the growing seed in relation to the kingdom of God, is that there is a commission that has been given to go and spread the kingdom of God. And that commission, if you remember, was spelled out in Matthew 28, verses 18 through 20. Let me share these words that Jesus gave before he was ascended into heaven and said goodbye to the apostles. Jesus said to them, "All authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely, I am with you always until the very end of the age." So when we think about the Holy Spirit coming in the Pentecost, and when we think about the kingdom of God being like a mustard seed or the growing seed, as we heard in Mark this morning, let's keep in the backdrop that the kingdom of God is spread by the Great Commission that were not only given to the apostles, but to us. And when we speak of the kingdom of God and how we're called to spread the kingdom of God by the Great Commission that we've been giving, we keep in mind that the kingdom of God are teachings from Jesus Christ during his 3+ years of ministry. The kingdom of God, isn't it a way of life, a way to live, a way to conduct ourselves as we go about living on this side of life? So the commission that the early followers of Jesus Christ and the apostles got after getting the Holy Spirit within them was basically a wonderful commission called to spread the kingdom of God, the good news, a way to tell all in the world that there is a new gospel to proclaim, a kingdom that is to be grown by us as followers of Jesus Christ, a kingdom that grows like Jesus talks about in the parable of the mustard seed and the parable of the growing seed. You're no doubt going to be out in your backyard over the next few days during this Memorial Day weekend and in the coming days. And of course, you have planted some seeds, haven't you? Maybe in your front lawn. Or perhaps you have put some new seeds or some new plants in your backyard garden. So as we're out and about this Memorial Day weekend and in the coming days, we think about creation that's part of that kingdom of God that we're called to spread, called to give to others. I think sometimes we overlook the fact that when we're out amidst creation that we maybe perhaps might take for granted the wonderful creation that is around us in the birds and the trees in our backyard garden. We also need to remind ourselves, I think, that God gave us dominion over creation, this wonderful, wonderful creation, the resources that we enjoy. And we need to remember that this earthly creation we're in right now is not ours, but it is God's. Creation, of course, is part of the broad umbrella of the kingdom of God, a kingdom Christ brought to us on earth. And let's also not forget, as we're thinking about the kingdom and the seeds that we heard about in the two parables this morning, the kingdom is broad in the sense that it's not only about creation, but it's about how we treat people around us, a certain way to act, a certain way to speak in the kingdom of God. And in our passage in Mark this morning, Jesus introduces us to the kingdom of God through the parables. Recall these words that he said about the growing seed. The kingdom of God is as if someone would scatter seed on the ground, and would sleep and rise night and day, and the seed would sprout and grow. He does not know how. Jesus went on to say, the earth produces of itself first the stalk, then the head, then the full grain in the head. But when the grain is ripe, at once he goes in with his sickle, because the harvest is done. The harvest is done. Jesus provides this wonderful parable, actually two parables. If you remember, parables were familiar in the time of Jesus. Parables were familiar to basically a mixed audience that Jesus was relating them to: Jewish Christians, skeptical Jewish authorities, and all in a time when most of the population was illiterate. And so the parables was a wonderful way to teach. And parables, as we know, are a wonderful metaphor, a simile that tells a story, generates discussion, and teaches about situations that people face in everyday life. Parables are also designed to create tension and resonate. They have no conclusion. They always tease the listener with possible applications. Parables were basically an established form of teaching in the days of Jesus, as they are for us now. Jesus used the parables that we heard in Mark this morning about the growing seed and the mustard seed to present an earthly story with a heavenly meaning. And Jesus also used parables to help people pass judgment to something to whose significance they might have been blind about. As we think about the parables this morning, and the parables also being a metaphor, a simile for the kingdom of God, let us remember regarding the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God that Jesus brought was not to maintain the status quo, but to upset the status quo, shake things up. Facing diverse crowds of his time, then including many people, again, who were illiterate, Jesus deployed the parables to describe the kingdom of God, the kingdom that he brought. We remember in the Lord's Prayer, thy kingdom come, thy kingdom come. So the kingdom was brought by Jesus, and of course it's here now. So facing the diverse crowds and using the parables to teach to them, he uses those parables to describe the kingdom of God. And Jesus, brilliantly, uses the world of agriculture that many people were familiar with, of course, at the time, to help teach the kingdom by using the example of the growing seed and the mustard seed. Let's also remember this as we hear the words in Mark this morning. The kingdom of God has a cultivator, and that cultivator had a modest background that he brought to us. And that cultivator, of course, was Jesus Christ, born under humble circumstances, nurtured by humble and loving parents who faced many challenges, including having to immigrate to another country and come back to have their child Jesus born, rather than being killed by Herod the Great, the king of Judea long ago, who ordered all firstborn male children in the town of Bethlehem to be killed. And then Jesus, of course, grows and presents to us the kingdom of God, a kingdom of God that was timeless. The kingdom, we need to also remember, it's a kingdom of not only the past, but it's a kingdom of the present. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. Jesus said it was already among the people. And of course, it's among us now. It's a kingdom of the present, a kingdom of the past, but it's also a kingdom of the future. In Luke, Jesus told the apostles, as he does us, it was God's pleasure to give us the kingdom. So as we think of the parables this morning, and as we perhaps stare at our geranium or our backyard garden, let us remember that the kingdom is not only like a mustard seed and a growing seed, it's also like a garden. Like the garden, our garden is a gift from God for us to enjoy and protect with the growing season that, of course, is now upon us. The plants that we see around us, they grow and they thrive on a pace and a timetable that's set by God, not ours. And the kingdom of God, advances like our plants in small ways and then large ways, and sometimes when we least expect it. I know, and perhaps this is the case with you, but I am utterly amazed sometimes at how quickly our plants and vegetables grow after taking our eyes off of it for just a moment. And of course, the food from the garden nourishes our bodies and our life. So the kingdom of God grows around us in short spurts and in large, large waves sometimes as we live among it. I'd also like to highlight the fact that the kingdom of God that Jesus brought and highlighted in his parables this morning is really about the fact that he presented a very broad canvas, a broad painting that we call the world, including the environment that makes up the kingdom of God and makes up that canvas. It's been suggested sometimes, and I think it bears worth repeating and us focusing on this morning, the fact that if you want to know what God is, you want to know what God looks like, survey creation around you. Survey that wonderful creation that envelops every day of our lives. I believe, especially as I look around creation today and look at the environment, that our natural world, the forests, the bodies of our water, the air that goes inside and outside of our lungs, I think sometimes we overlook the damage that has and continues to be done by our creation that's around us. Creation, again, that is part of that kingdom of God. We rightly focus as members of the kingdom of God, first and foremost, on our behavior, what we should be doing to be in favor of social justice, to help people. But the environment always seems to be tucked away in the background sometimes and doesn't get the attention that it deserves. Unfortunately, the environment has been getting more attention lately because of things that aren't so positive. We see in the news and on TV the reports about turtles and dolphins and sharks getting entangled in plastic in fishing net. We hear the news reports, I think you've seen some of them, of how plastic increasingly is showing up in our bodies because of some of the residues of the plastic, because of some of the materials that we use. We must do a better job when it comes to creating, protecting our creation. I really believe that. I also think it's important to recognize this. When we hurt creation by the pollution around us or by not taking safeguards to protect the environment, we hurt creation. In those times, we also hurt God. I really believe that because creation is made in the image of God. We're made in the image of God. God loves us. So therefore, God wants us to treat with proper respect and guard creation. Creation created by God, thought about by God long, long ago. My friends, in this Memorial Day weekend, whether we're out and about in the midst of creation, I think it's important to remind ourselves that God created all around us to enjoy on the ground and in the air and in the water. Let us think, how can we do a better job at showing our love for God by protecting creation around us? Also this morning, as we think about the parables and the kingdom of God and spreading the seeds, let us think about how in the kingdom of God we have a call to love our neighbors as ourselves. When we think of it in that context, let us think about how is allowing policies and laws and actions by humans that lead to degrading our environment and negatively impacting the lives of people around us a sign of love for our neighbors? How is allowing miles and miles of floating plastic in the ocean a sign of loving our Creator? Or allowing more species of plants and wildlife to disappear? How is all of that showing love for God who created creation? And how is that about furthering the kingdom of God that we're charged to do? The kingdom of God, the growing seed, needs tenders of the garden that we call creation. We feed, of course, and we already tend to the kingdom of God so it can spread. But more must be done to protect and safeguard creation. Growing the kingdom of God is not enough. Creation must also be saved. Jesus, the original spreader, the fertilizer of the growing seed, and the son of creation, creation, of course, of God, calls on us to do more than we already have been doing to protect our natural environment, making up the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God needs cultivators. We cultivate the kingdom of God, but we must do more. We must redouble our efforts to be good cultivators of the kingdom of God. People look to us who are involved in the church to be part of the kingdom of God and be examples of Jesus Christ by our words and by our actions. So let us continue to do that. And think about this. Regardless of our status quo in life, whether we're retired, young, the elderly, I believe we must act now more than ever to protect creation. Silence and inaction are not options. Our environment is hurting. We must stand out in protecting the environment. Yes, spread those seeds as part of God's creation, but also protect creation itself. Sometimes maybe we might think about this. Maybe God needs people that are really good at speaking, people that are really good at mixing with people and talking to people to spread the kingdom of God and to protect creation, rather than us, who we might see sometimes as being rather humble and not able to perhaps be great public speakers. Nothing can be further from the truth. We may be humble, but we are still called as humble people to spread the seeds of the kingdom of God and protect creation. Remember this, God chose the son of a carpenter to start spreading the kingdom of God. God chose a young sheep herder named David to be the king of Israel, one of the kings of Israel. God chose us then to protect creation, to further the kingdom of God, to seed the kingdom of God even further. And And Jesus Christ is counting on us to do that. So when it comes to growing a healthy seed, whether it's in our garden or in helping to grow the kingdom of God, our Creator perhaps says this to us. When it comes to growing the kingdom of God, spreading the kingdom of God, add water, but also add you, to further nurture, protect, and save for future generations and our children and grandchildren the kingdom of God in terms of creation, and to teach the future generations to spread the seeds of the kingdom of God also to future generations. God, my friends, is essentially counting on us to continue fostering the kingdom of God and its essence, its wonderful essence. And we do that by redoubling our efforts to carry out that great commission, the same commission given to the apostles, to spread it, live it, and breathe it by our actions and words to all in the world. Remember, we are inheritors of that great commission, and that great commission entails spreading the kingdom of God, the seeds of the kingdom of God. So let us continue doing that. And in the process, as part of being called to spread the kingdom of God, to oppose oppression, oppose injustice, love our neighbors, and be the church. Be the church. And as that song that I think many of us know so well, let people around us know that we are Christians by our love. By our love. God is counting on us to spread the seeds of the kingdom of God given us long ago. Let us go forward and do that. Now please pray with me. God, the Holy Spirit, you are the restless breath of love that sweeps throughout the world. You move where you will, making all things possible. Inspire each of us to hunger and thirst for justice. Sweep through our world, bringing great change, please God. And may the bounty of your goodness be shared more justly, so that all may share in the rich blessings of your creation. And for us, bring transformation in our praying and living so that we may act justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you all the days of our lives. And God, on this day before Memorial Day, we remember that when people join the military, they give up a part of themselves for the sake of neighbor and nation. They give up some of their freedom. Our soldiers go where they're told to go. You do what you're told to do if you're a soldier. It is one form of putting the needs of others before your own when you're in the military. Lord, as we anticipate Memorial Day, a day in which we say thanks and recognize and honor those who died in service to our nation, we offer up now this prayer given to us by the Reverend Chris Duckworth, a pastor and former U.S. Army chaplain. We pray his words to you, God. Creator, you are our strength and our shield. We give you thanks for the men and women of our armed forces, past and present. And we especially pray for those who have gone before us, who have died while serving. May their sacrifices serve the cause of peace, and may our nation be ever grateful for their service. God, with your wisdom and strength, guide our military leaders and give to all people a desire for justice and peace. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. And God, we honor and pray your holy name by living up to the inheritance of your salvation, as we bear the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior, with passion for his work and reconciliation of all the world. God, let us not squander the freedom that we have been bequeathed by those who died to preserve it. More than any human system, let us live as redeemed disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ, by whose life death and resurrection, we are made freed indeed. Remove from human beings the arrogance of power, God, our will to anger, our reliance on weapons, and our love of violence sometimes. Make us instruments of your peace, God. And where there is hatred, let us sow love. Where there is injustice, let there be love and pardon. Where there is discord, let there be unity. Where there is doubt, let there be faith. Where there is despair, let there be love, God. Where there is darkness, let there be light. And God, where there is sadness, let there be joy. God, create with us humility and strengthen our trust in you. Make us agents of your peace in all places, God, and we lift up to you the persons whose names we gratefully remember this day, who have served in the military and gave the ultimate sacrifice. And now, God, we pause in silence to present to you our own personal prayers and petitions to you. God, look upon your bereaved servants who have gone before us serving in the military with your mercy and who made the ultimate sacrifice. Also, Lord, remember that we are in your midst every day. We are alive now and forever in your living presence. In the name of the Prince of Peace, our Savior Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. My friends, thank you for being with us today here at First Congregational United Church of Christ in Imlay City. I'm Reverend Dave Forsberg. I hope you have a safe and wonderful Memorial Day weekend. And again, remember the sacrifices that have been made by those that gave the ultimate sacrifice. And let me send you off now on this reflection and into the days ahead with this benediction. We know some things that are as solid and sure as the ground beneath our feet and the sky above our heads. We know God is love, God is love. We know Christ's light endures. We know the Holy Spirit is with us and found everywhere, found in the space between all things. It is closer to us than our next breath. It is binding us each together until we meet again. Go now, my friends, in the name of the Father and the Son of the Holy Spirit. Go in peace to be a seed, to spread the seed of the kingdom of God that is all around us, now and forever. Amen. Take care.